that. Good morning everyone. I'm very glad to see many of you have already joined very timely, even a minute before time. Today is going to be exciting, little stretched, and should be interesting. So while I will go into the details of what we cover, however, let me share briefly what will happen today and tomorrow. We are going to look at how models analyze an image. So how a machine learning model processes an image and how it recognizes who the person is. So we are going to work on face recognition model today. There are many things that we will look at. How do we define what is a problem that we want to work on, and then how an image is converted into machine understandable form. For this problem that we are looking at, which model to use, then we will go into a particular model type, which is support vector machine. Then what are the machine learning steps we will see today, and so on so forth, evaluating the model. Then we will also write an algorithm. I will try and cover today neural networks, so which is somewhat in many ways it is similar to machine learning. However, there are two key components that differentiates neural networks from machine learning. We will cover that using a set of equations, and we will also try and derive particularly the gradient descent that we discussed, that is instrumental for neural networks to effectively function. And then tomorrow we will go into details of convolutional neural network, the same problem which we work today, where a machine learning model is used. We will use a convolutional model tomorrow. We will also use plain neural network or vanilla neural network, typically called as artificial neural network, which is MLPs, which is multi-layered perceptrons. So they are all fancy titles at one level, and also can be intimidating in terms of different words they use. However, we will understand the nuances of what exactly happen in that machine learning model or a deep learning model. I also have Ms. Anuradha here. She wishes to say hello to all of you, and a very, very interesting and exciting announcement she will make. I will try and keep this to a slightly different form where we can see bigger picture of her. Yeah, madam.
Thank you, Molly, and good morning, everyone. Firstly, want to start off with apologies for the yesterday problem. Not much in our hands, but we have tried to fix it in a number of ways, and hopefully we'll not be getting that problem once again today and tomorrow. But that's a hope and pray, because it is not in our hands. But we have done alternate arrangements and etc. actually. So let's see, there might not be any of problems, such problems today. And also, once again, every day I mention to this faculty, please do not put other information in the FDP groups. This group is specially made to learn artificial intelligence. And yeah, most of you are deleting, but every time somebody forgets, so everybody's sometime in the morning, in the night, everybody puts it. So please think before you post anything in these groups. Okay, and important announcement that Mauli and I want to make is, as a follow-up session to these sessions, because these five sessions will not end all the knowledge and it will gradually fade away if you don't work on it. So what we want to tell is, in next month, June end, we will be again conducting a two-day, again three hours refreshing session, which will give you again, which will remind you of all the topics that we have discussed over these 5 days, and also bring in some new topics. So that's what we want to do. Meanwhile, what I also want to tell you is, we have mentioned in the beginning that faculty gets additional certification if they can submit exciting projects. So we have made arrangements for you to start thinking. It is time for you to start thinking about how you utilize all the concepts that you have learned in this program as part of some project. So there are certain parameters in this project, like feasibility and cost and what's the goal, how many people it will impact. So there are some parameters for this project, and a very knowledgeable panel will be formed to judge these. Okay, those details all I will be sharing with you. And today you will receive a mail which will have details about project submission. So it is very small. It's even if you are in the ideation process, you can submit. And so this will be, the results will be again declared to you during next month end when we are having the follow-up session. Okay, and next announcement is, I have asked yesterday in the feedback form if you are interested in giving a bite, a video bite about the feedback. And thank you so much, around 500 to 600 faculty have shown interest to give a video bite about the feedback on the project. So our coordinators will reach out to you for a small 1 minute or 30 seconds feedback. So if you just put 30 seconds, we'll be grateful for this effort that we have taken. So they will reach out to you and ask you for 30 seconds. Another one is, around 500 to 600 faculty have shown, colleges have shown interest for the Centers of Excellence. So the Centers of Excellence, as I have mentioned earlier, also have number of things like connected workshops, hackathons, ideathons, campus interview preparations, faculty development programs, and industry interaction, HR mock interviews, number of programs that are going on already for the Centers of Excellence, including the advanced diploma programs and internships with other companies. All these things are going on. So you can utilize this right now, and we want to start off these in 20 colleges at the moment. Before this quarter end, we want to start off in 20 colleges. So whoever has shown interest for one college, if 2-3 faculty have shown interest, we will send one mail only to all of them together. So we will be sending mailers to you to submit an expression of interest from your college. You have to submit an expression of interest. Once you submit that expression of interest only, we will contact you for next steps. And the MOU can be done online, and the activities can be started immediately. The on-campus activities will be started once you start the college. But I will advise you or request you to start off those online programs immediately, which will benefit the faculty, the students and the college in various programs. So even we will be sending expression of interest mailers to all the faculty who have shown interest to start off Centers of Excellence in their own colleges. So these are the important announcements I want to make, and don't want to take much of your time. Happy learning. Today there are a lot of fancy titles that you are going to learn, and all the best for the same. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. All right, let's look at where we can go today. I want to start with the credits to the universities and the organizations that who have contributed to what I'm going to share today and this week. There are many faculty members, particularly majority of them are faculty at Stanford, and there are other practitioners who have contributed to this. There are interns who have also contributed significantly around putting the data together. I want to highlight their names as well, Rishita and Kavya. All right, we will today look at which problem we are going to work on is face detection. So before I go into details of the face recognition part, how this entire face recognition has started, very briefly, while you can get more details in the facefirst.com. The first study on automatic facial recognition systems started in 1960s. So it was semi-automatic. They had this tablet called RAND on which we can provide the inputs, and there is a computing system that runs and recognizes the face. Fully functional facial recognition has come much later, in late 70s and 80s. There are 3-4 different scientists who have come up with this model. So interesting developments have happened in early 2000, where two-dimensional, I'm sure all of us understand, is length and breadth, is two-dimensional, where three-dimensional is we also have a depth part. So we are talking about a two-dimensional one is something like this. So this is X and this is Y, something like when you are in front of you, what you can see is forward movement and sideward movement. That is two-dimensional. And three-dimensional brings the additional dimension, let's say the depth, so you can also see top and bottom. That is the third dimension we visually provide like this. So we have images which can only provide 2D format. We have images which can also provide the depth. It can show more details like this and so on. So now these studies have after 2000 we have intensive studies both on 2D and 3D. Now while there are different approaches in the face recognition, broadly we call them as analytical approaches and global approaches. Analytical approaches work at a local level, global approaches work at a broader level, and there are also hybrid approaches that detects the face. Now, in the analytical approach, it looks at the distance of the determined feature points and the angles between them, let's say between the nose and the cheeks, eyebrows, and the different parts of our face. So we have forehead. So we have forehead, and these angles are looked at. Shape of the facial features or the variables containing these features are obtained from the image, and they are analyzed to look at the who the person is. This is broadly analytical approach towards facial recognition or face recognition. Now, on the other hand, we have global based methods. These are applied to face recognition more from the feature extraction point. So in feature based methods, this was not there. In the feature, in the global models, we don't need to extract the features. Instead, it works on the pixel level. We can call this as eigenvalues. We use this in principal component analysis. So the eigenvalues, or simply put, we have all these pixel values. We look at those pixels in the form of vectors and draw the data out of it. So the global methods are more accurate over time because we will be able to generate a lot of information. Analytical methods, on the other hand, may not provide this level of accuracy over time. Now, so while broadly we have now information which are based on the feature extraction of where the nose is, where the ears are, and what is the angle difference in this particular face's ear vis-a-vis in the other face's ear. Now the global models are different from the perspective of they look at all the pixel values and pull. Now we will go through Olivetti data set as part of our learning of models. So the Olivetti data set has 40 different people data. This was captured over a 2-year period in between 92 to 94. There are 40 people, so I will try and highlight some of them. So we have this 40 people whose data has been captured, and each person for each person there are 400 pictures available. So we have all put together 400 pictures are available. Yeah, we have 400 pictures of each face. So this is slightly different. 400 pictures of faces available in the data set. Face images were taken at different times. We also have lighting is different, facial details are different, and slightly angle change and so on. So all the faces in this data set are grayscaled. So these are not red, green and blue. Instead they have a blacked out scale, which is a grayscale. In addition, all these images are already pre-processed, which means they are converted from an image to number format, which are pixels. We will go through them in just a moment. Now, while the images could also have been captured in different sizes, they are all been brought down to 64 by 64, roughly 4096 it should be. It should be 4096. Now those many pixels are only now available in all these 400 images. In addition to that, while I did talk about, typically when you look at this part in a normal picture, if on your screen also you can see, on your screen also this one you typically have 700 plus and multiplied by you have 1000 pixel size. This is what you have. Now on the other hand, when we bring this down to 64 by 64, it is already pre-processed and we can look at them. In addition, each pixel value is anywhere between 0 to 255. Now this is also been scaled down in this particular data set to 0 to 1. So you are familiar with the normal distribution where we can scale down these 0 to 255 values to 0 to 1. So therefore the values will then become 0.30, etc. If there is a pixel size which is 255, then it will have the value of 1. So this is how it is being scaled down. So 40 people are encoded and their names will not be appearing. Instead of the names, they have been kept as 0 to 39. So what essentially I am talking about now from this data set is like this. You have 400 documents, 400 people's images you have. Each of these image, the person name, instead of the person name, the target variable, or we call it as output value, is kept as between 0 to 39. 0 means one person name, say Mahesh, and 1 is Kishore, and so on and so forth. These different names are encoded as numbers. Now in terms of input variables, you can imagine that every pixel is one variable. So we are talking about 4000 plus, say 4096. I will also make sure that this number is correct. We're talking about 64 into 64. Yeah, it is 4096. So 4096, each pixel become one input variable. It's like yesterday and day before we discussed some input variables where x1 to x6 were there, and we had the target variable which was the charges, medical charges, the insurance charge we were looking at. The input variables were number of children, gender of the person and so on. Now in an image like that, every pixel becomes one value. So that's where the complexity increases. You have so input 1 and input 2. Input 1 or x1, both I'm using it synonymously, input 3 and so on so forth. You will have 4096 inputs, or 4096 x values are here and only one y value is here. However, it is not a binary classification. It is not a linear regression. Why it is not linear value, not a continuous value? Why it is not continuous value? Reason is that different faces, there is no same unit of magnitude from one face to another face. So therefore it is a classification. However, there are 40 different classes, which means this is a multi-class classification. This is what the data set that we are going to work on. The multi-class classification is the target variable that we are going to predict. and there are these 4096 input variables that we have. Isn't it a very large number? 4000 input variables, very large number indeed. And we have to somehow work with this, identify the patterns between these input values, those pixels, and the target value. And this is fascinating. If you look at the pixels are in different rows. However, when it comes to the input values, everything becomes one single one, and we don't know which is adjacent to which other pixel. And all of this is just kept as in one order without really having that number of rows and so on and so forth. All right. In any case, Olivetti is the data set that we are going to work on. Kaggle is the source for this data set. You will, if you go to kaggle.com, you will see different algorithms, different data sets. It's an open source platform for practitioners. Sorry. All right, now if you have to transform the image, there are many ways in which it's already been communicated, and I'm sure majority of you are aware. Image, so it can be vector graphics or raster graphics or .img file or bitmap file. Now, typically, what is the size of an image? If you take a picture from your mobile phone, which is likely to be more than 10 megapixel camera, that would have, let us say you have a 10 megapixel camera, and that will give you a image size of 2592 by 3872. So which is roughly, let us look at what is the size of the image that you can take from your mobile phone. Yeah, I just want to make sure it is correct. 2592 into 3872, yeah, it is 1 crore 36,000. 1 crore 36,000 is what we are talking in terms of the values that we can get. 1 crore 36,000 pixels you will get from your phone camera. That is the size of it that you can get. However, if we have all of these as variables, normally we deal with 5 variables or 10 variables is what we deal with, and 1 crore variables we can't handle. So these pixels can be compressed into the sizes that we want. So there are ways in which we can bring it to 30 by 30 pixel. The clarity and the depth of the pixels image will reduce drastically. However, you still have the features of the image available. So this is what we are talking about in terms of height and width of an image. You can take even a small image or bigger image. The pixel values, depending on what camera that you use, that is what will determine the number of pixels. It will have very high depth if you use a smaller form. It will have slightly sparsed depth in terms of the pixels for a larger size. However, when you take with this 10 megapixel, this is what you will get. All right, let's look at the next one. Now, how does computer understand images? While we can recognize this is a dog, this is a pet, this is a dog. Now, for a computer, everything is in the pixel formats. Now, this is as an illustration for you. With the same image has been, imagine that we have this image appearing in the here. Now, this image, if you peel it off, the way machine looks at this image is more like this. So let's say this is the image, and you go inside it. So the image is basically presented in this form of square blocks. Each one is a pixel. Now, a pixel is a digital image, is a 2D array of pixels. Each pixel is characterized by its XY coordinates. However, for us, it is let's say one pixel that we are talking about in each of this. Now, suppose if this is a colored image, which is what the dog is, the colored image, then you have an array where you have three different colors, red, green, blue. However, in grayscale, instead of three, it will be only one value. So you will have any one value, which is maybe you have grayscale for this particular pixel, it could be something like this, maybe 68 is the pixel value depending on the color. If you want to know what is that color that it is talking about, you can always see the color palette here, where Let's say as an example, you can look at the color value here in terms of what color we are dealing with. If you go here more colors, you will see 0 red and 165 green or 223. Yesterday we have looked at different color combinations. So I would encourage you to take one block and see what color it belongs to. We can even play around with one block very quickly to see what it is in terms of the color. So this shape, if you look at, we can make this color into, let's say we will have all zeros. So basically the grayscaled zero, this is how, without any color, which means it is black. Now if you have all high scores, which is red is 255, green 255, blue 255, obviously it will look at white color. However, we are in the brightness, so for us, in the sun rays, we cannot recognize. For us, it appears black is a color. In reality, without the sun, you will recognize that everything is black. Alright, so this is how, and you can change these color palettes there to recognize what are different pixel values resulting in which color. Okay, let's move on to now how is this particular value of 68 is being stored in the machine. Now the 68 will have again a vector format, here we have not mentioned. So the 68 will eventually be presented in the form of some sort of a vector. It's a multi-dimensional vector. You have 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0. So if it is a 10-dimensional vector, this will have something like this. Now what are these dimensions? As good as the length and breadth. If this is x and y, or this is length and this is the breadth, and you can have a third dimension as depth, and this is fourth dimension, let's say something like a time dimension and so on. And I can only imagine four dimensions in our life. Fifth dimension may be a very different plane in another planet, possibly can be a fifth dimension. So in a 10 dimensional vector, this is how the data is presented, a 68 number. So every number will be presented in some form which the machine can understand. So I'll repeat quickly what happened in the image. While the image is in some sort of a picture like this, it can be any size of pixel. Pixels can be reduced to some manageable scale, but more importantly, each pixel has a value of anywhere between 0 to 255. And this, in a colored picture, there will be red, blue, green, and if it is a grayscale, then there will be a single pixel value. Those pixels are converted into a multidimensional array or a vector with zeros and ones, which machine now can understand. That's how it works. So the moment you have all of this into numbers, that itself is adequate, because we worked in the linear regression, logistic regression. All we do in the data processing is convert the categorical values or any values into numbers. So that's what the magic is about image processing, I would say. Now let's move to the next one of now for our Olivetti data set, which model to choose. So to decide on the model, we have this a sort of handy thing where there are four blocks. You can have is your target value continuous or discrete. I'm assuming that you still remember what is your target value. Is it continuous or discrete, and do you know what is your target value? First thing is, do you know which is your target value? DYK, let's say it, you know, DYIT, do it DIYS, do it yourself. Nowadays that is a big thing for amongst children. So do you know what is target value? If you know what is target value, then it becomes supervised learning. If you are unaware, it becomes unsupervised. Now in our case, we have those 0 to 39 different faces. So all the 40 faces have a label. Instead of the name, we have some number associated to all 40 faces. So the answer is yes, we know. So the moment you say that you know, then this is what is the selection. Now our target value in this case, is it continuous or discrete? Answer is, this is a discrete one, and therefore you have to choose this. So final one, we have to choose one of the classification or categorization models. There are many different classification models. The base model, I would say, is logistic regression. Logistic regression is a base model, which we will discuss in a moment what it is. Then there are many other models like support vector machines or decision tree or so on so forth. So there are so many other models that exist. We will begin with, since we spent some time looking at linear regression, how is this logistic regression exactly defined, at least at a high level? Let's look at that piece. Now, linear regression had the equation for pattern recognition is, pattern identification is y is equal to mx plus c. So in this case, the y being minus infinity to infinity. So there are many professors, I'm sure, who are from mathematics and even computer science engineering professors, you will be, you might be using these linear regression models. Now, we have to move to in a classification, let's say binary classification that we are talking about, then the y value has to be, is from 0 to 1. So which means you have to quash your y value from minus infinity to infinity to 0 and 1. So there are ways you can do. You can use odds ratio to bring it to 0 to infinity. So odds ratio brings it to 0 to infinity. Then you can again use a log function to further transform the value to 0 to 1. So you can do, when you follow these steps, this value becomes is equal to 1 by 1 plus e to the power of minus mx plus c. So whenever I am right, because I am using a simple mouse, it will take some time, probably in future we'll use some sort of a pencil or something that can use, that can be used on the notepad. Now this is what it gets transformed into, the y value. So which means if you have 1x, then 1 by 1 plus e to the power of minus x plus c, or if you have more variables, let's say you have 6 variables, like last time we discussed, it is m1 x1 plus m2 x2 plus m3 x3 plus m4 x4 plus m5 x5 plus m6 x6, like that it goes on till m6 x6, when we have 6 variables that we spoke about. And then there is this bias or constant value that will still be. Now it, the data is, then the resultant you will get it, the value as between 0 to 1 only. Now this is one method of a binary classification, a classification model. So essentially what happens is, let's say you have apples and oranges that you have as a output. Or yesterday we also looked at whether a person would have cancer or not, let's say lung cancer or not, whether a person has lung cancer or not, yes or no. This is what you want to figure out. There are different data variables, and let's say you have only one value, which is precipitate, something like a tumor, the abnormal cell. So you have the tumor size, abnormal cell size that we have as an input. So depending on this size of the tumor, what can, whether a person would have lung cancer or not, yes or no, has to be determined. And let's say these are all different variables of this thing, and probably in this case we might get so if the tumor is what we are looking at, probably something like this, we will get, there will be a threshold, until then we have the values of there is no tumor, and this side there is tumor. Yes, I will present it probably something like this. You have the data points like this, where there is a tumor and you do not have, just as a depiction of when you have or when you do not have. So there are, so yes or no, so this can be yes and this can be no, something like this. So this is what is a logistic regression is, and where we have an equation like this that will determine vis-a-vis what we discussed yesterday, which is a different, slightly different equation. Just a moment. This is what will provide it. We could use for the Olivetti this equation. When we do that, the difference that we get is we will have 4096 x1 to 4096 x's will be there, x I mean here input values, I will use this term input values, 4096 input values is there, will be there, and then we have to do multi-class classification. Logistic regression has that facility. I want to share slightly complex model, which is a support vector machine, which is evolved at one level from the logistic regression. However, the support vector creates some sort of supporting lines, a boundary lines. So this way, what happens is probably I will draw it in another page. Of course, we are going into greater details of support vectors. If you have any questions that you have, you can always write down there in the links. If it is still buffering, it should not buffer, because we have done a lot of work to make sure that the speed is adequate. Whenever it is buffering, please refresh, and if it still doesn't work, please send a message. We have alternate methods in which we can probably ensure. Today it is fairly good, I would say. Alright, now from the logistic regression, if you have to create a support vector machine, let's say you have a classifier like this, a binary classifier. And what we are trying to do is, let's say you have a line like this, which is the classifier. It creates a boundary, which is something like this. So there's a line, and then here also a boundary line, and says that anything this side of the boundary is clearly defined as, let's say, lung cancer. Yes, anything this side is not that well defined. It is clearly defined as lung cancer. No. So these support vectors are created. So we will look into very high level maths. I'll give the notes, but I will talk about the support vector machines at a higher level, different aspects of it. This model is more efficient in terms of classifying your binary or multi-class classification. So your regression, the classification can be done effectively in this particular aspect. So I'll have to write this to something like this. Alright, so I'll say this is what SVM we are introducing. Now let's get on to the SVM. So you know that we can't use here regression very clearly, so I'm not going back to it. Let's look at support vector machines. Now some bit of theory, yeah, these are available in separate. I'm also assuming that you are going through the data that we provide, we have been providing you, and so there are a lot of information we have here. I will try and share some bit of information from this, how support vector machine can be defined as it. It is used for classification and regression analysis. It's a supervised learning method and outputs a map of sorted data with those margins. So these margins, if they are farther from the classification line, that much efficient the model is. That's how we talk about. Now support vectors are simply coordinates. So these are the coordinates which will be touching points in the closest proximity to the classifier. Now this is also called the hyperplane. That is, the classifier is called hyperplane. This margin width, the wider the margin, that much confidently we can say that the data is classified. Now support vectors, you have some data here which with the lower capacity, that we can say the optimal hyperplane stems from the function class where that lower capacity is, which is closest to the hyperplane, we can say. The classifier is called hyperplane here. Now what is a hyperplane? Probably we have more details here. In a two-dimensional data we could clearly say this is hyperplane. However, sometimes you have some data like this. Just give me a moment, I will try and make it bigger so that even when we are trying to work out using some sort of drawing, it will be visible for you. Alright, so now let's say we are working with something where you cannot really classify in a two-dimensional space. You have like this, and then let's say these are all the dots is one type, and you have the lines as another type, and you have these two different things. However, the problem is you have some dots here also, and you have some lines here also. Let's say you have something like this. Now in a two-dimensional you can't draw a line clearly. What we can do on the other hand is, if you raise it, probably we could draw something like this. So you can create maybe something like this. So I know these are too many curves, so however finally you can pull something like this. See, if you keep in this fashion, you have now segregated dots from the lines. Now when you go to the third dimension, higher dimension, you will be able to make that hyperplane, clear hyperplane between this based on that dimensions that you raise. That is a possibility in a multidimensional environment. This is one example that shows that you have two input values x1 and x2, you can come up with the y using a hyperplane. Alright, how do we find the right hyperplane? When we know that the wherever the farthest value or closest value of a particular type coming to the hyperplane, and we have that margin, longer margin, that can be a right hyperplane according to us. So here if you look at green dots, this particular green dot is closer, this particular blue dot is closer. Okay, I'm not able to, I hope you don't see base part, so I'll put it like this. So this particular green dot is closest to a hyperplane, and this blue dot is closest to a hyperplane. You can have a hyperplane like this, you can have a hyperplane like this, you can have a hyperplane like this. These are all hyperplanes, these are all classifying it well. So these are all the possibilities. However, the right hyperplane is something which has those nearest items with the wide margin. That this is one way of explaining the right hyperplane. We'll share with you these details. When there is no clear hyperplane I spoke about, we will increase the dimension from a two-dimensional data. In this case, let's say if you have to create a blind, then probably we will have to make a curve like this. Yeah, instead if you raise, and let's say these something like in a bucket of water, and you are keeping something, you have some sort of a sponge ball kind of thing, and you have some sort of a slightly heavier plastic balls you have, or let's say you have plastic balls and marbles. Normally in a two-dimensional, both plastic balls and marbles are on the floor. Now imagine while you are seeing from a two-dimensional, it is in the water jar or a water bucket. If you look at it from the top or from the side, they are all together. From the top they are all together. However, if you look at from the side, you can see that plastic balls will be floating, and the metal or the other ones we spoke about were heavier. What we talked about was, let's say, some sort of a rocky heavier ones, they will be below in the bucket of water. So this way, because of the third dimension, you can easily then draw a line segregating what is up and what is down. This is what we call it as a third dimension here, and you can keep increasing the dimensions to get that hyperplane set. Now there are methods, kernel methods and kernel tricks. We will look at a high level again what these are. Now in the kernel trick, it avoids explicit mapping that is needed to get linear learning algorithms. So to learn a non-linear function or a decision boundary, if you look at in this case, it is as good as in water we have these plastic balls in the red color, and you have the heavier pebbles in green color, they are in the bottom. So these things you can use kernel functions to bring that distinction. Now there are many different kernels, we will not go into it. And why I want to share this with you is, while you understand the concept of margins in the support vector machines, you also need to be aware there are these kernel concepts which helps in creating those hyperplanes without really explicitly going for an additional dimension. Linear kernel method, so you have a mapping function. So you can do a processing by which you will get this linear kernel. Polynomial I will not go through. Sigmoid kernel, so in general, what is a linear and what is sigmoid? So one way to say is, linear is your y is equal to mx plus c, or in linear you have y value is anywhere between minus infinity to infinity. Another way to say is that between y and x there is a linear relationship. the linear functions means there is a linear relationship between your input values and your output value. This is what we talk about. So between input and output values, there is a linear relationship. In a non-linear relationship where you do not have that perfect match between x and y, you have non-linearity we talk about. In non-linearity, one way to say is, it is instead of minus infinity to infinity, it is 0 to 1. This is one. Second thing is, so the values of y will be between 0 and 1. Another aspect in the non-linear is, the relationship is, it is inverse and then it is exponential, 1 by 1 plus e to the power of, I'll simply call it as some x. I can also call this as let's say this is simply some x value, 1 by 1 plus e to the power of minus x. So these are sigmoid kernels. Sigmoid kernel is a non-linear, or sigmoid function is nothing but a logistic function. Broadly, logistic function you can call it a logistic function is this value. All right, let's now move to RBF kernel. I will not go into details, except for there is something called a gamma value. So I can create different clusters. When we were talking about let's say plastic balls and the metal ones, which are plastic, which are metal, we can also have, let's say, in that water, in this the plastic is of different type. You have the heavy mold plastic. Heavy mold plastic is with the weight. So basically, whether it will drown or float is dependent on weight and volume. So I'm sure many of you would be teaching in some form or the other weight and volume. If the volume is high vis-a-vis low weight, then it is likely to float. Now if the volume is small, like a metal piece or a rock, but the weight is very high, then it will drown. So it will sink into the water. This is what the relationship is. Let's say there are some heavier molded plastic pieces in between. They are not fully floating, and probably maybe, I don't know if there is anything called, they are not in the bottom of the things. Then you have some in between. So with the gamma value, if gamma is 1, then which means there is only single partition, and this is a support vector. Let's say this is more like this is that margin and this is the support vector. If the gamma value is converted to 2 or 4 or 5, then it will try and see, can I make more clusters here? So we will use this gamma value in our support vector machine SVM classifier that we use in our algorithm. So please keep this aspect into consideration. How can we identify right hyperplane? I'm not going to get into this particular equation, because I wish to spend time today explaining you the neural network equation. Deep learning appears more like an enigma. You can refer to this notes itself and understand it. So for each vector we have, it is as good as mx plus c, where we are saying m is the weight here, w into xi. Xi could be any number of input variables, and b is constant or bias, for xi having the class 1 and class minus 1. So instead of 0 and 1, we are saying the lung cancer is there, yes or no. So when lung cancer is there, 1, and lung cancer not there, minus 1. So this is how, let's say, for each vector we have these two equations. So we will go into details of so these are basically constraints, two constraints. 0 and 1 are defined like this. Let's say it is less than are equal to this and greater than are equal to that. So as two different classes. Now to understand more about, let's say these are minus 1, we have initially mentioned this as a zero value. So in this, to explain the what is the right hyperplane, the best example that we could take is minus 1 here and 1 here. So with a binary classification, and then you go into the detail saying that this is the nearest one from the hyperplane. So we don't know the hyperplane, but if we see the farthest point from the blue side, which is like no lung cancer, this is the farthest side. From here, these are the farthest side from this point of view. A and B are farthest points where the lung cancer, yes, there is lung cancer. Now when we go to the next one by defining, yeah, I will share more about this in visual form. There is a, I could attempt and solve this for you, but this we will save this time for the neural network purpose. So I will put it like this. This is the margin that we will have to finally arrive at. This margin will tell us the better, which is the best hyperplane, right hyperplane to choose. So we need to figure out what is H0 and H1 so that we can get this margin value. So we have few points here. We looked at earlier, there are 3 points which are touching here. So these points can be a reference points for us to really go ahead and compute it. Yeah. Now directly you cannot get the margin value, however the method that we can do is from here we can figure out what is this value, this right angle, because this data is moving in this direction. Similarly here also you can figure out this side. W is perpendicular to H1, so H1 is the value that we know. This tangential line can be drawn for a data point here, so therefore this value we can compute. So I will remove this so that, yeah. Now we will compute that value as let's say u is equal w by modulus of w, then modulus of u becomes 1. We get the, now this is a single value, we cannot have the computation, but we can create a vector k by with mu where modulus of k is equal to m. So k is now perpendicular to h1, now k is a vector. So when we get this k value which is a vector, then this particular margin, whatever is the length here, the same length will be the margin value. That's how we can compute it. I will leave these details to you so that you can practice and check for yourself. There is another way where now the z0, you can have a two-dimensional data here. Z0 is a point on h1. So this is the point. Now this is nothing but there is a point here x0 where you have both the xy values, because this is a data point. Now you have got this margin number, so which is now k. You add the k, you will get the z0 value. So that's how we have the details here. There is also numbering that's been put by one of our members, Vamshi. So you will be able to look at these aspects. Now, all right, there are non-linear support vector machine examples also, which we need not go through it. With this broad understanding of you can compute it, mathematically we can solve this equation, and gamma is the one which will help in segregating the numbers. You also have a concept of kernels without having multi-dimensionals to create the support vector machines. This information is sufficient for us to consider and go ahead and practice that. Now, as part of practice, we are going to open our Jupyter notebook. We will look at the data set, the file that we have, and we will have to execute. I'm going to do some sort of a refresher of what are different steps that we have followed in the last 2 days whenever we are executing machine learning model. See if you can understand. So while I'm going to explain it through a spam detector, this is one of the professors in Stanford. He used this, and this is heavily adopted from his data with only some minor changes to it. So initially we have to acquire data. So earlier we had looked at, let's say, medical charges data, medical charges or Boston data set. Boston data set, for example, was gathered from a source where, and then scikit-learn has installed it as part of them. Now we are looking at Olivetti data. Now it is readily available. However, when we are delivering for our products and projects, let's say we will have to put together the data, and sometimes we have to gather through Internet of Things. We will have this data from a drone or so and collect, or a running machine and collect that data, so, and then process it. So once we have it processed, now the images which we gathered from 92 to 94, that's been collected and they're all available. 400 images are there and they're all classified very well, converted into simple pixels, input variables, and 64 by 64 they have been done. And further, they've been scaled. Instead of 0 to 255, the values have been scaled to 0 to 1. It is well processed and readily available data. That is what happened. You look at your data and we realize that there are 40 different images are there. 40 different people data is there, and that's how we could say that these are all the Y values. Those names were kept, we understood the data, and then we create train and test splits. In case you do not recall, now when you have let's say 400 images, if you use all 400 images to train your machine for pattern recognition, so we said, right, there are three steps. There is a pattern recognition step, pattern identification rather, pattern identification step, and second is, while identifying the pattern, here you will use some sort of initializers for the coefficients, m values, c values, henceforth I will try and call this as weight. M is nothing but the coefficient is the weight because it is a multiplier, c is the bias because there is no perfect match, so you have some sort of a bias to bring that identification. So these values, you have taken some initializer, some 1 or 0, 1, 1 or 0, 0, some value you have taken, and then you got it some error. So what error is that? Which equation do you use to compute the error? Now, how do you reduce the error? So what is the method in which you can optimize your pattern identification model so that you optimize it using some sort of a method so that you will reduce the error? And we discussed on the gradient descent method. This is we can explain the explainability of gradient descent is there. There are other models, something like Adam optimizer. It is super complex. Of course, gradient descent also has so much of computation. You will see post the break, after the algorithm, last 1 hour will be spent only on the neural network complete equations. So I would request you'll have to stay active for it. Now this is the third one. Now all these three things, if you use for all the 400 images these three steps and finally you get the pattern, you believe that very good pattern has been achieved, very well pattern has achieved, where will you test now? You can't test it without any data. So therefore you take some portion of this, use it for testing purpose, and then the remaining portion use it for training purpose. This is where you can segregate the data. Then you will have to create and refine a specification, which attributes you will retain, which one you will drop, and so on. Then you will build the model where you will follow these three things, and then you measure it. So earlier we looked at measurement using just the error value, sum of square of errors or mean square error. These are the options that we looked at. If you are looking at, let's say, a data kind of lung cancer is there or not, people in Hyderabad, how many of them would have lung cancer? Now you will realize that of a, let's say hypothetically, we have now with the floating population and all, we are 1 crore people. That's it, 1 crore people. Now if in this 1 crore, the people, number of people with the lung cancer would be, let's say, 10,000 people. Now 10,000 is what size when you have in a 1 crore, 1 lakh is 1%, and this becomes 0.1%. Now in a data distribution, 0.1% is the number of people with cancer, and in your model with 99.9% accurate model, if your model is 99.9% accurate, still it will just say all these 10,000 people have no lung cancer, and still it becomes 99.9% accurate because there are only 0.1% of the people with the lung cancer. It's such a small percentage. So your model can be 99.9% accurate, and still it can wrongly identify all the 10,000 people as no lung cancer kind of thing. So if you use a regular mean square error and sum of squares, any of these models to evaluate performance of the model, then you will not get accurate data. So today we will talk to you about there are other methods we can look at, not just accuracy of the model, but there is also something called sensitivity, there is an F1 score, and it is all taught through a confusion matrix, rightly named, I don't know who, confusion matrix. We will look at that post break. We will optimize it. Once you have an error, how do I minimize that error? Maybe I should train my model more number of times, or I should change the model type. I will go and use random forest classifier. This is another decision tree based model. In decision tree, the same segregation happens slightly differently, probably at a high level. I'll speak post break. Now, after we come back from 5 minutes break, I'm going to also look at the questions and try and answer as many questions as possible before we get on to the next steps. Break. All right, welcome back. Let me look at the kind of questions that have come up today. Yeah, so the question is, SVM gives boundary lines between two classes, but regression only fits data. How can they be same? Yeah, I am assuming the question that's being asked is about logistic regression. And then, yeah, here, let's say I will create here. Now, if it is a logistic regression, it fits the data. Yeah, it is try and let's say a sigmoid curve, something like this, where it is 0 and 1. Finally, we will determine at some confidence level of let's say the 50% 0.5. So long as the predicted value is 0.5, until there, this is the line that I draw. Every point that is falling this side is considered as 0. So this is because this is 0 to 1, and everything that falls this side, and obviously you'll have many lines like this, and you'll have many lines like this. That's how you have the sigmoid curve forming. So on so forth. All right, now you cannot have anything beyond this. Everything is kept to one. Now this is regression that is fitting, and all I am trying to do in support vector machine is that you change this order slightly and say that this particular classifier center that I have, I will have some sort of a margin. Broadly imagine like this. So instead of sigmoid curve, if I put, you have some data points here this side, and you have some data points this side. You have earlier you used to draw a line like this, and this is a best fit line, 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 and this is a best fit line. These are all lines, these are 100% accurately classifying your data set, and this is logistic regression. I am using for a good hyperplane, there is this margin I am taking here and here, which will be much better than many other types of classification which were also giving 100%. That's how I made the statement of improved version. How to draw hyperplane for multi-view depth videos. Videos have to be processed. It will be a next level professor. It will require more efforts. Sir, can you specify which algorithms is best scalable? Scalable is, I will answer it from the perspective of you have more input variables, which algorithm can handle it well. So you have more input variables, this is one question, and you have very 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 minute difference between this side and this side. How do we answer? So I would say that SVM is excellent, naive Bayes is very good. When you have data where the number of variables are much more, and here the difference is much less, and you have to handle the complicated things, then you go for neural networks. Suggestion is, to the extent possible, always try to use the simplest possible models so that you can understand your data better. You essentially trying to look at what is the relation between input variable and output value. That has to be, so the models are basically for you to understand data. The question is it like we will be extracting features from images before using SVM? So now we are not using analytical model. We are basically, SVM is completely relied on the Turk curve, where it is a global model. So where we are looking at all the pixel values, and in the pixels, one way of explaining the pixels is, let's say these are the pixels that we are dealing with, and you have different people whose face, somebody's face is like this, somebody's face is slightly different, and in this form. So when somebody's ear will be very different, somebody's nose is different. So essentially we are looking at which pixel has how much brightness. So that is a sort of giving you the feature extraction. In fact, we use this term feature extraction, but in reality it is all global model. We are not going by features of really that is a ear, this is a nose. No, that is not what we are looking at, and this is the angle in which we are purely looking at the pixel brightness or dullness. If it is very bright, what is it? If it is very dull, what is it? That is what we are looking at. So therefore SVM is working on the plane numbers in a global form. Can you please also highlight on measuring performance metrics for SVM? We will do some bit of programming and then go to the this question is performance metrics, how do we measure? So we will understand confusion metrics in detail before 12 o'clock. I will make sure it is taught. How can we compare SVM and regression? As oh, this is the same question again that came probably two times. So boundary between classes and regression fits only data. So this is a similar question. I'm assuming that we answered all the questions that came up. In case you have more, please let us know. I will quickly go through any other view that has come. Impact of GPUs for deep learning. So now my machine, it is all CPU, central processing unit. My own processor is running right now, and I have for example, if you want to see my machine configuration, you can look at here. I can see it is 16 GB processor memory that I have and 2.4 gigahertz processor. Now a graphical processing unit, I will have I have a onboard graphics unit which is 1536 MB, but you have a separate GPU, a much evolved form. In the GPU, the GPU is probably, I will convert it as every GPU is equivalent to maybe 100 CPUs or at least 10 CPUs. Let's say 10, at least 10 CPUs a GPU is equivalent to, and also TPUs there. The question was, what is the impact of the graphic processing unit on deep learning? Number one, here the processing capacity of CPU is not adequate. Here we are only dealing with 400 images. So you will all be working using deep learning for 400 images, and I can work easily on my local machine. But if this becomes in reality 4 crore people, and 4 crore people, each person has 5 different images of each person. So totally 20 crore images if you have to process to classify who the person is, then my central processing unit is not sufficient. I will end up using GPU. Now these GPUs run on cloud and they burn a lot of electricity. So while your deep learning models require GPUs, they are going to burn a lot of energy, and you can safely understand that the GPUs and other thing is called tensor processing units. Google came up with this term tensor processing unit, which is again slightly evolved form of GPU that will further burn the energy, and thereby your overall environment is going to get affected. So with so much of research happening by using these GPUs and to an extent TPUs, we are in fact spoiling the environment. I would say that this is the kind of negative impact it has. So we have to be prudent when we are using higher processing capacities for learning, deep learning purpose. And to the extent possible in real world, we use machine learning models only. We might test it, but we will go and use a machine learning model. We will write a code. We don't even take the libraries from the scikit-learn. We will try and write down that algorithm using the simpler coordinates, etc., and build the model. All right, please share screen. Oh, yeah, my mistake, I think. Just one more question I am seeing here. Suggest one suitable technique for image segmentation. We will discuss this in CNN tomorrow. For image, if accuracy is 99%, if predict all answers, so what does it mean? Yeah, I'm now sharing the screen. My mistake, I think till now the screen was not visible because we were not on the main live piece. Now you can see the screen. Okay, so probably what I tried to draw was here, this was a sigmoid curve more logistic regression. In this case, I tried to draw it as a slightly different logistic regression and drew the lines. So probably you have not seen the screen. And then while the best fit line, I will, though it is a repetition, I'm going to do it once again. While it is a best fit line, you can have many best fit lines which clearly classifies, but a right hyperplane is one which will have higher margin. That is perfect. There is another question, if 99% times if that is giving accurate and still if the model is not good enough, what does that mean? I spoke about when you have 1 crore population, in the 1 crore population you had 9 crores, 99 lakhs, 90,000 people. Let's say 90,000 people, these people don't have lung cancer, and there are other 10,000 people, these people have lung cancer. So in this example, these people have lung cancer, no, and this is lung cancer, yes. In this example, now if let's say your model predicts wrongly that all 100% people do not have no lung cancer, they have no lung cancer. So what is its accuracy level? So the accuracy is computed by looking at what is the number of times it accurately predicted. It predicted 99 lakhs 90,000 times it predicted accurately, while only 10,000 times it went wrong. Now in a 1 crore, this 10,000 mistakes are only how many times it is a mistake? It is only 0.1 times it went wrong. It was wrong only, the accuracy wise, only 0.1 times it went wrong. And all the other 99.9% times, it accurately predicted. Still, your objective was to figure out who has propensity to have lung cancer so that you can give them some sort of treatment. Now if entire society, if their model says 99.9%, you can't do anything with the model. So what do? We will change the measure that we are looking at. We will no longer use accuracy as a measure to predict, to evaluate performance of a model in this very biased kind of data set, where, not biased, we call it imbalanced data set. This is very imbalanced data set, and in classification you commonly face this. You don't have so many people having cancer or any severe health problems. In our today's context, let's say you are trying to predict if anybody has coronavirus, yes or no, and 99.99% of the people do not have coronavirus. So it will obviously, a model, if you use accuracy as a measure, it will go wrong. We have other metrics to use, which is what we will talk about. There is something called F1 score. I will talk about F1 score and how do we arrive at this F1 score. A wonderful way to explain this is through confusion matrix. We have confusion matrix where something is true and false, and positive and negative. I have that information, let me share in some time. Now I'm going to go into, we will talk about it as we progress. Now I'm going to go to some bit of coding. Those of you who are practicing the code, then you have to focus now. This is my terminal, and as a shade I use on the shell, and this is a MacBook, so the terminal can appear slightly different. Here I've created one environment, and I'm going there, Conda activate AI training is the environment that I have. Yeah. Now in this on this environment, I'm going to open my Jupyter notebook. All right, we will also make sure whether we have internet or not now, and what is the speed of the internet. I'll keep checking this. We have an alternate method in case this doesn't work, and this is the best one during our test we figured out. So streaming, you should not have any buffering. If you still have buffering, then it has to be at a local level so you could improve. So once I open on my Jupyter, this is what I see. All my folders, so somewhere root folders will appear here. and these are my root folder. My files are in desktop. I'm going to spend brief amount of time on some basics of Python 2 before I really go on to the particular Olivetti data set for a face recognition part. Now I have the files. So Python basic code, let us look at it. So we have so essentially a programming language is like our communication language. It also has some sort of characters, letters, and then words. There is grammar, etc. In the same way, we have in programming languages, we have types of data. So data types, we have what are different types, and then these data types, this can be integers, this can be decimals, this can be characters, this can be words, strings, and so on. Boolean, I could say all these five which are recognized in this Python programming language. Now each type of data, let's say integers, how do you structure it? You have to make it in the form of a table where you say there is some relation between the values and so on. So there are different data structures available in it. You can, we have in Python, you can put the label data in a set. So you just together and all the unique values are there. And there is no order, they can, you can't really tell which is first, which is next. Data sets are there, type of structures, and there are many different structures we spoke about yesterday. We have tuple, we have dictionaries, we have lists, which we use extensively. These things, we put them in the form of a data frame. This is what is the table that we always refer to. Now, once we have this, all we need to know is how do I add, modify, delete, or how do I make sure they don't change, and how do I know where is the position of each value? We call it as indexing of the value. These things we need to be aware of. How do I transform various values within a variable? How do I recognize the index of that variable, and so on? Then how do I read a file? How do I write a file in the programming language? Now all of it, what are the punctuations? When do we say full stop? When do we say comma? When do we say exclamatory mark? When do we say apostrophe? These syntax are there in Python, in any programming language. So broadly, while they are there, I will go into dictionaries. I will share at a high level. Dictionaries are unordered collection. Dictionaries are mentioned in the form of this flower bracket we have. So this is how we have the reference of the dictionary. So we have key, while it is not ordered, but every value has a key reference. So you can even call the value using that key. Do not try and practice right now while talking, because there are some of you who may not be keen on the programming bit. For their purpose, I will be at a very fast pace in explaining the programming bit. However, I have already shared this data with you, so you could practice and try it out. So you have dictionaries are always put in flower braces. Now another thing is, you don't have to mention the type of data. The Python, it will recognize by itself. While it is very advantageous at one level, when it becomes massive in terms of data, it takes longer time to identify the type of the data, and thereby Python sometimes is considered slow, which is another reason why there are programming languages like Go, which are becoming popular. Of course, Ruby is another programming language which also have opportunity or potential to become popular in future. However, if you are into programming, I would suggest to keep an eye on Go programming language. So that has some bit of promising. Next couple of years, I see Python continues to be a leader because it has so many libraries. You don't have to do the coding of a linear regression or a support vector machine on or a neural network, because there is a library you can just import. We will also look at that. Now type of this particular data, you have it, the type of the data structure is a dictionary. It has responded the values which are there. It is providing this is the list. And another aspect here, so when you don't have the value, it will say it is not there. A length, this is list is presented differently, and you will see the age designation here under employee. I will also talk about employees are defined like this. You have the moment it is a flower brace, then it is dictionary, and if you keep like this, this is the key value, and key in that key is these are the values. So you can consider the key as an attribute, and this attribute of x1 has these values. There are three different values, so three different objects. So the first object Virat, 30 years with some designation. So we can see the captain. So the role is cricketer. So cricketers is mentioned only once, so it will repeat for all the objects same thing for the fourth variable. I'm assuming that it is clear, and I can create a new key. However, is there any important aspect in dictionary? Yeah, how you can refer to. So you can call the data using just the attribute, which is the key. Employee role, so it will say cricketer. So it can, if you ask employee age, it will provide you everybody's age because they are all unique values. So employee age only 0 to 2. I spoke about the first value in Python is 0, and it will go on. And the last value, if you want to do and you don't know how many objects are there, all you can say is just say -1, that is the index, and you will get the data. I will now move to, let's say, if else, and more importantly functions we should see, because we use functions extensively. If else, you are familiar probably in other languages, so the operators are very close to English language. Is equal to, you have a plus equal to means you can add to the previous value. It is in addition to the current value plus another value, and that is equivalent will be assigned to this particular entity or an object A. It is minus can work, you can, it works with star equivalent to, so you can use that. Then membership operators which are there. So I told you this particular line, it is not essential, this is only for printing all the data together. Now just give me a moment, probably I will avoid some bit of disturbance. All right. So string, let's say string is lines, and we can call the string, and we can, is SCI present in the string? True. Not in the string. This is in membership operators. These are membership operators you can look at. Now important is if and else. We will look at one example and move on. Let's say if 8 is less than 9. Then you keep this colon, print 8 is less than 9, some statement. So it says prints. Now, so it understands the numerics. Now, let's say in another case, answer, we have assigned answer as left, a string is assigned to this, if answer equivalent to. Now you see this is a conditional statement, so therefore we are using 2 equals to. If it is yes, then you print this. Suppose if answer is equal to left, then print this. Else print hello, I am else. Suppose if let's say right. So obviously this is going to print hello, I am else. See, you got here I am else right now, because the assignment operator, the assigned value is left, but we are trying to check if it is right, the other one. So I'm going back to the previous one, and you will see how low I am. If, yeah, in fact, here on assignment is changed here, and you have more examples. I will move to the next one, which is, now let's see for loop. We will look at for loop is extremely useful if you are going to write without any library that you import. Let's say linear regression or SVM you don't import, then you got to run the iterations again and again. Gradient descent, you will have to do a loop to continuously perform the same operation. You assign M value and C value, which is like weight and bias, then go forward, look at the identification, look at error, and to reduce the error you use a delta. We discussed yesterday the partial derivatives of partial derivative, how you will reduce that error value. In fact, we will talk about it post the second break, where in the neural network gradient descent comes into picture. Now, their for loop is extremely useful. Range, you can get the range value, you can provide, and it will provide you. And if you ask for the list of the range, it will give you the entire data. Now, let's say you have created another list where you said you have 400 to 500 and I want 10 values. So it is smart enough to figure out that there are, I have to identify 10 values between that, with so it will provide that data. 10 additions, I could say, we can put it like that. Now, you can also do 500 to 400 and with minus 10, you can your list provide all the details of the list, it will give you. Let's see now, if you put minus 5, perhaps this will give you more idea because it has to reduce by the minus 5 value, so you will get 20. So now if I make 20 here, I'll get minus 20, I'll get only 5 values because it has to reduce the value 20 from each of this. Now let me keep here 10. Now in this list the range is 400 to 500 but with a step of 20. So we call this step value of 20. So it will look at with those step values how many times it can, how many values it can give. Alright. Now let's look at for moving on from range. For I in range 10, print I. So in the range of 10, can I get the I value? So it is these 10 values it has provided. Now more details we can say. For I in range 10, print I, print say this is the company name. Alright, so we will now look at list. List can handle different data types. It need not be one single data type. So we discussed that. So in list is put in square braces. It is not flower braces, so square. Now for list has this four. For ELE in list, print ELE. Is there a ELE here? Iterate over the list under, okay, we will print ELE. So there is no ELE in the list, so it has printed only those values. Otherwise, it could have printed this. Alright, let's now look at index in range list, what we have. So these are all the, do we have that as index values? Alright, these are the values it is printing. Now for loop, perhaps the way we could look at is, we can have in this is a good example. How do we create a list? So we create the list with this, and for I in range length of the list, print that I value hyphen. And so length means it is moving to index value. So the length, so in I, and then provide the list of the actual value here. So that's how you are getting the index hyphen and the value in that index. And I said the 0 onwards it starts and ends with the closer number. You can try with the more examples. So there is another example that we have here. This is an empty list where you have so initial list is empty. In the first iteration, let's say you have multiple iterations, I in range 10. In the first iteration, you have some value and go on adding the values in the loop. So you will get those responses available. All right. So with this, we will move to probably next one. NumPy at a very high level, let us see quickly. We work with NumPy extensively in numbers. In fact, the current model that we are looking at is we have the file also, instead of comma separated values, we have we are taking a NumPy value, which is there. So import NumPy and create an alias for it so that you can call with ENP. It is not essential, however, when you have too many algorithms, multiple algorithms, and you know what you're going to do with that particular library that you import. So it is better to have an alias that you have. So NumPy, and then it has array in it, array of the values here. And now this becomes an array and provides the value. So you will work extensively with NumPys and pandas. Is there any good example to share? Yeah, one dimensional, two dimensional, three dimensional arrays. So your matrix multiplications, we've not gone into details. However, you know, when it is row by
column, then you have those many columns, we will get the data. So an example here is you have a row and the column. If you have to multiply, then you will have the number of columns will be your array size. The matrix value is will be bigger with all the data. On the other hand, if you have the only one column initially and then all the rows, so then if this is what you are multiplying, then what you get as a result is only one object, one row of value. So it's a high level I'm talking about, the one-dimensional array and multiplication. Two-dimensional array will have two, where you can specify within this list values. Here, a three-dimensional array you can have, where you can mention with the third value. Here, you have this, if you look at, so this is one dimension, you have another value, and so on. All right, so this is still I'm getting, okay. So with this, we will now move to the other one, where functions, I want to share a little more about functions, so that how we create functions. So here we define a fairly simpler format, define the function, give a name to that function and have this empty braces, and use this colon, which we were using even in the if-else statements we were using, and then have any instructions, provide any instructions within that function. Later, if you call the function, it will execute. Now, in this function, you can even use provide some arguments. So here, let's say user and provide, let's say I'm calling it as hello black bug engineers. So I will here now I have defined a function called greet, and then user is the argument I gave, and say hello. Hello is the string, comma, that argument value will appear here. Now when I execute this here, I'll get hello black bug engineers. So that's how can create. Then when user is equal to you have different ways in which you can highlight. Let me look at another example in the functions, and then you can go ahead. Yeah, for loop in the functions, we define the factors of a number. If you want to give mathematical operators, we can use, and then we can get the we can return factors. So let's see another example where we can probably go into some even or odd number. Yeah, you can do this modulus, whether it is an even or odd. Any value that you provide, it will say whether it is even or odd, not. So for that, this is the name of the function. This is the argument that you have to pass. You have to provide this number so that it will give you an answer. Even is equal to empty. Both are empty lists now. One list is number dot split. So and then now integer I, for I in the list that we have, for I in the list, if I modulus 2 is equal to 0, then you consider it as append, even value. If else if I divided by 2 is not equal to 0, then you consider it as odd. If length is odd, it's 0, and so on. So now we have this logic that is being provided, and finally, depending on what the value is, then it says even or odd. So when I run this model to, okay, I'll have to call the value, then I can immediately say whether it is even or odd. I have that possibility. Let's say here we have a value, here we are calling, either we could call there or here. Now we can give the number here, a is equal to input, enter the sequence of numbers. It is just a string, so it is showing me a string. Now even or odd a, it is asking me, you pass an argument, I will give 34. 34 is even, there is no odd value, and 33, even is none, odd is 33. So it is showing it. Little bit of, we don't need these many else's, if, etc. However, let's say we've created this as an explanation purpose. You have this. So primarily now we are looking at how do we create a function, define a function. It is useful for us to know. And let us also look at pandas. Yesterday we have referred to pandas to call the comma separated value CSV file. So we can, this is how, if you are not calling a file inputting, then you can create a dictionary, which within the dictionary, this is the key and this is the value. We call it as key value pair, and keys are nothing but your attributes. Values are the object values or attribute values. That's how it is appearing like a table. You see, when I import pandas as PD and data frames, these are called data frames. I call the dictionary into data frame, automatically this entire data is appearing in the form of a table for me. All right, I can even call, so print df1 or just say df1, it will pretty much the Jupyter notebook provides an output like this. With this introduction or refresher to Python, we are now going to look at the Olivetti data set now. Let's look at Olivetti data set. I do not know. So I am exiting from the from this because I accidentally closed it. I exited from the Jupyter notebook. Now I can again input. Once I click the Jupyter notebook, I will automatically get Python uploaded. Python started. My Olivetti data set or the algorithm is under FDP here, and I'm saying this is about face recognition. So day 4, image Python. This is where I have face recognition. I tried to keep files, face recognition file. Thank you. Now in this, I'm hoping there are no big surprises. Instead of can we use classification yesterday? Okay. So there are no, but I will again 12 o'clock, I will look at these questions, and some questions are to execute in logistic regression. I will try and do it on this data set itself so that during the break I will do it and show you after the break for you. All right. In this, we are importing NumPy file, NumPy library, and creating an alias and pandas and creating a PD. Now, the file itself is npy.npy. So NumPy is what we need. Matplot library is to show the graphs. A lot of these models are used to understand data. So you can visually understand data through graphs and visualization techniques. I have not gone into details of explaining what is a bar chart, what is a box chart, when do you use a pie chart, and so on. I've not done that. And I also did not go into details of how would you, let's say, look at multicollinearity. What is a relationship between the input variables and so on, reason being that you will be able to look at them, and or you may be aware, some of you may even be aware of it as you teach in the classes. All right, now from machine learning standpoint, I am keeping the importing train and test split. Hope you will understand the train and test split is allowing. I have 400 images, I will take some for training my model and the remaining for testing the model. That's how. So though we are not going into unsupervised learning, principal component analysis is about is coming from there. See, today I have 4096 values, 4096 variables are there. We were talking about each image has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 till 4096. Every pixel becomes one input variable. So if I have to do with so many pixels this input value, then it becomes complex for me. So instead, what I will do is I can compress all of this using some techniques. And one of the techniques that I can compress is principal component analysis. While I will not go into it, what happens here is that it will quash this. It will combine all of it and try and extract some bit of data from it and say, do I, and then we say now it creates a new set of variables. We can't understand the values over there because it is interpretation is not possible, but then it is studying, analyzing this and try and get some value of it. So you will keep getting till a particular stage, you will get a lot of learning. And after that, you will say that, look, even the components or the additional variables, they are getting flattened. You don't have much information gain beyond a point here. So as far as we are concerned, keep this as simple as principal component analysis is about compressing the input variables into some sort of manageable variables which have some sort of good information about a particular image or input object, every object, whatever it is there, and that object information is there, which is what is relevant for us. Now, since we are using a support vector machine, I will import the support vector classifier. This is a kernel classifier. I can use different kernels there. However, the default is a linear kernel classifier. I also told you about you have linear kernel itself without any kernel you can have that is called linear SVM. That is a different library. All these libraries are part of sklearn. Then we are going to use evaluate the model through matrix confusion matrix, which I will talk about soon. In terms of data, so data is available with me here in the form of, I'll make it bigger so that you can see the screen. I have in the image, I have the data like this. Yeah, you will see the same file is available in different forms because something we have put artificial neural network, one of them I have CNN, one of them I tried with the different models, random forest classifier, etc. We have a colleague, Vamshi, he has attempted testing it. I can quickly go over those alternate models also. However, the one that is developed here, put together, is only the primary logic and the related attributes. No data visualization stuff here. So it will be clean. Now, important is olivetti_faces.npy has the data of those 4096 columns. So this is where the olivetti_faces.npy. Yeah, this is the one. So it is a 6.6 MB document. You will receive this. And then the reference to each of that object, the target value is kept separately in the other file, which is olivetti_faces_target.npy. So all I have to do is load that file. You know, in pandas we have done pandas dot or pandas alias dot read_csv or tsv. If it is a tab separated value, you call read_tsv and then just call the file. Since my Python file, this one, and the data set both are in the same folder, all I have to do is quotes and I can call that. Similarly, target values where faces, instead of name of the person, we converted that into 0 to 39, those 39, 40 people data will be available here. Now, let me see, did I run this file? Let me run here in front of you. You get this asterisk mark here, which indicates that the file we executed here. And then it ran, then this one we will run, it quickly ran through. Then let's check the details in these files. So let's see how many images are there. So all I have to do is call those, I said index of it. Let's call how many indexes are there of this data. In the data, totally how many indexes are there, and we are getting the 400 images, 400 indexes are there. So it will also index, each index is assigned to one attribute. Now we are looking at in print, there are format, how many unique values are there in the target value. So in the target, everything, all the 400 should be only X number. That when we look at in the length of it, how many unique values are there, and we got 40 unique values. We are good from that point. And important aspect is, what is my data shape? So I am checking my data, which is the input value. What is the shape of it? Shape 1, shape 2 in the data file. So it is saying that you have in the shape 1, 64, and shape 2, 60, another 64. So we now know 64 by 64 are the values. So you can define this shape. You have so many columns, you can create that into a matrix and say that some X values is one shape and then Y and the other is another matrix. It's a matrix representation of the data, which we can do. And this is the biggest thing. It has already been scaled to 0 to 1. So if you look at what is the value that we have in them, so the value in the data file, every value is between 0 and 1. So, and we have taken some examples. So from 0, we have asked for some 4 different values. It showed 0.30, 0.36, 0.41, 0.44. You ask for 10 values, so it will give you different. So the, your highest is you will have, let's say, -1. I'll keep -1 will give me last value. So I have 0.7, 0.95. I have till 0.2. It is randomly giving some data for me. However, you see that I got 10 different values. So -1 and say some 4 values you give me which are high. It is not giving me in order, but yeah, this is fine. It is at least giving me the value. So if I change here the data -1, it's not giving in order, which is fine. So basically we have entire data between 0 and 1 only, which is what is more important for us and we are comfortable. Then print the target values, which are all the unique in the target. So target has to be only those 40 faces. So 0 to 39 it should be. So, and it will give us the answer 0 to 39 it printed. Now I am also going to, it is more for our understanding, while this is not really required for the model execution, for you to see how many images are there, what are they. So I have defined a function here and it says show 40 distinct people. This is largely adopted from one of the Kaggle responses, so we find that to be good, so we adopted from there. Show 40 different distinct people is the definition of the function name. It has two arguments, images and unique IDs. Now what we are trying to do is we will create a 4 by 10 subplots in the figure size, so that we will have those, the data will appear there, figure. So this is a lot of code. I will not go into details here. And finally, you flatten the data in this format. Now look at the iterations for unique ID in the unique IDs, image index you take, and then unique ID into 10. You can then call and ask for showing the file. And this the map is grayscale, which is what the data itself is grayscale, so we don't have to worry. Now we using this the tabular form of 64 by 64, those values which are 0 and 1 are now getting converted into the actual photographs of those people if we execute this file. So let's say that we will say show 40 distinct people, that function, and images is nothing but the data, which is the data is the file here. Data is called np.load olivetifaces.npy. From in that the np is the numpy dot unique values, so whichever in the target whatever are the unique values you provide this connection. So x and y being this, all the target values I want, whatever is there in the target, and x you give me one data of that. So you will have, now I'll execute this file and see, execute is run, and then now if I run this file, asterisk mark indicates it is executing. Now you see all the 45 photos. Now I will try and increase the size further so that you can see. These are the 40 faces which are there, which are different people, both male and female pictures are available, which were taken during 92 to 94 of people. Is the data. So if you look at face 34 is a female gender just as identification, and let's say you have 9, 7 are female genders, many of male gender. So for the machine it is not like that. What is the irrespective of how this face is appearing, it should be able to accurately detect, yes, this is a particular person's face, that face ID 14. So that it should detect, that is what we need to figure out from this method. And like somebody requested, I will do during the break, logistic regression, I will apply and show you post the break. All right, now that we have, otherwise you don't need this piece as part of your code. I can just keep it as, I can do a command M. Okay, I have a way by which I can do this code into marked. I can do a markdown of the code, yeah. So it will not execute for me. So then I will say like this. So the reason for which I'm doing this is the code will appear very, very simplified. We don't need this to run your model. Now, similarly, I'm going to the next one, and that is I've also created show me any 10 faces that I want of a person. So for that, I've again created a function within that I have to call the data. And here I can specify through this function, what I can do is I can specify which person data I want and from which file. I can take it from the data file, that is my input images, and whose pictures I want. I can just refer to the ID and I will get the 10 different faces of that person. So that is what is the objective of this function. I will run this here, and then here I will keep, let's say we will keep 1 and 7, 8, 9, 14. You can keep between 0 to 39, there are 40 different people, and if I execute it, I should get it is processing wherever we have this person 7, 9, 14. We have discussed of this name, so I picked that name. And you have, so if you look at this person face ID 1, here there is one shape, and here it is a different to the person mouth is open, here it is much more open, here it is green. So you have different ways. And look at face 14. So here it is normal, smiley, and little serious, then a cushion, and like this there are different facial expressions. So there are the 6 broad expressions we can look at. And still the model, without any analytical method, is globally looking at only the pixels and identifying the person. So look at this person. This person is seeing this direction here and this direction here, and here eyes closed, and still it should be able to identify. For our model purpose, this one is also not required. I am keeping this into a markdown format. There are shortcuts too. Right now I'm not able to recall. You can always check. So I can, if I don't want to, I want to keep it into code format, I can always again go back, instead of markdown, say code, and it will appear and ready for execution. All right, I'll keep it under markdown right now. All right, we are going further. Now, again, it is already shaped, and we know this is perfectly in this. Otherwise, you can always reshape it to this format of X and Y, the matrix format you can get starting from it. However, our model is already reshaped and ready. All you have to do is check. We don't need any of this, and just say, or let's just say X dot X. X is the value where we have pushed our data. If you look at our data has moved to X. Where is that? X defined as, I'm checking where have we moved data into X, otherwise it will throw an error for us. Yeah, it is here only. So here X is nothing but data dot reshape. However, it is already reshaped into it, so it is better we run this file. All good. Okay, we ran this, and now we have 400 objects. Basically, we are talking about, there are, let's say, though it is a repetition, I will still do it for the people who are not familiar. Yeah, so in our data set, now we are talking essentially our Olivetti data set is like this. In this, we have totally 400 objects. That means 400 pictures are there, and these 400 pictures, these are all having into 64 by 64 pixel format, so which is resulting in 4096 64 by 64 format. All these pixel values are here. This is a pixel value, this is a pixel value, and so on. And finally, you have the name of the person. The name of the person, Y, these are all X, 4096 X's and Y is 1, and the names are disguised into 0 to 39. So the 40 name, there are 40 unique names. Finally, you'll have any one of the numbers. So those 40 unique names or 40 unique numbers are kept. All these 400 objects are into this now. All right, with this understanding, we've shaped it. Now we are breaking it into train and test. So I'm keeping it as 70-30 here right now, but I think our test size is 30% of the data, so I can even change it to test size to you can have a ratio of train test split to be anywhere between 70-30 to 80-20. You can even use 80% of the data for training purpose and 20% of the data for testing purpose. This is good enough, where you have good enough number for training and reasonable numbers for testing. If you have small numbers that you take for testing, where you have, let's say you take in a 400 records, you took only 10% for testing purpose, then 10% is only 40 people. So sometimes some people data you don't even get to view because this 40 is equivalent to those 40 classes itself. So thereby we suggest that you have a reasonable split of the data. When you have this split of this data, now this bit is, I told you about principal component analysis, where it is used for decomposing the data. So you can do that. So, and then any model when we call, we have to fit the data into a format where it can understand. So normal, standardized normal distribution format it will go. And now you create a new data set with PCA and transformed values. So in the transformed values, what is that you will take? How many transformed values should you take? For that, let us first see how much of, when you convert it into, you have decomposed the data, how many values are coming. So I tried to draw a graph which says PCA and the PCA fit values one side, and also I'm using explained variance. So in the data, as you create new variables, there has to be some variance available. And cumulative sum of that explained variance you provided. So I kept this in the y-axis, explained variance, y-label, and in the x-label I kept the components. So when I clicked this, so I'm making sure that this has been executed, this is executed, and then PCA is not defined. Why is PCA not defined? Okay, I need to have some base value for PCA to run. Okay, we'll have some nominal value. So two components, I can take any number. So it ran. However, the actual number of components that we finally see is based on this variance. Now I see there is a 0 till 50, 60, till 50, every new variable. So I'm saying from 4096, which is there, these things I am trying to convert into. So when I did the PCA, till the value x1 to x2, x3, x4, till x50, the compressed values, there is a huge variance, which means each decomposed new variable is giving a lot of information about classification for me to segregate people. But 50 to 60, it has come down slight, but still huge data is there. 60 to 70 is also good, 70. But after 70, it really, really tapered, and around 75, it's really come down very drastically. I think then we should just take 50 till 70, we can take. Should we take till 70? 70 is here, if I draw a line, maybe I'll take till 75. Till 75, I will take. And after that, I don't need, while it is saying you can get 80, 90, etc. I will just take only 75 for my purpose, because that is sufficient for me, 75. All right, I will just change it to 75, because after that I'm not getting. Now the default value of 2, I will change it to 75 components, which is what is my input variable. So 4096 input variables now post decomposition, they are resulted in 75 values. Now these 75 are input variables for me to classify my 0 to 39, 40 different faces that I have, and on this I will use support vector machine. So we'll take a break, come back and run on the support vector machine, and we will go through the remaining code here. And we will also look at starting with questions, followed by support vector machine code, followed by logistic regression code, and then we get into very, very interesting aspect, which is with the interesting aspect being neural networks. Our 5 minutes break.
All right, let's get back to, I'll start with the questions that are coming up, that have come up so far in the last 1 hour. Okay, let's see the questions. And
speak loudly. Oh, many, more than 20 of them. SVM is also a classifier which classifies the data by using high dimensionality. Can we use high dimensionality in logistic regression? Yes, we use high dimensionality in logistic regression also. That's why we have what is known as multi-class classification in logistic regression also. Now, I will see if I have the data right now. I don't have. Tomorrow I can show the logistic regression, how we use high dimensions for multi-class classification. Yeah, how to draw hyperplane for multi-view depth videos. First of all, video has to be processed into different frames. So probably, and then frames have to become an image, the connected image. Then on the image, if we try and identify who it is, we have to classify. So a lot of work, both for video files and audio files, have to be done before it becomes as a single piece, and then that gets converted into some sort of a vector or these numbers that we are talking about. Now, can you specify which algorithms is best scalable? I already answered that scalability is two things. One, can it handle many variables? One. Second is, can it handle many types of, many classes of data? So we have many methods, and then if the difference is very small, how to do? So that way, deep learning models have great capability for the image classification, text and video. These are very complex, text one, because text you have to sequentially generate. How are you? If we ask, I am good, thank you. I am good, full stop, thank you. Like this, all have to come. Sometimes if you are doing at a character level, then I am G, all of it has to come. So super complex text analysis. So therefore, deep learning models are good. Otherwise, machine learning, I see SVM. SVM and naive Bayes classifier. These are classification models. These are excellent classification models. Very efficient machine learning model is extreme gradient boosting, XGBoost. We have, this is an ensemble model. This is built on decision trees. Decision trees classify the data. If you are looking at these 40 images right now, we are classifying, then decision trees classify this data either through heterogeneity or homogeneity, because homogeneous or heterogeneity. So the randomness heterogeneity is called there. They call it as entropy of it, and then homogeneity is Gini index. This is the way in which data gets classified. So there is an equation for either of this, that is like our pattern identification equation. Under normal logistic regression, we would have used y is equal to 1 by 1 plus e to the power of minus x. X minus that value, x being wx plus b, w or mx plus a. This is the value we are talking of, wx plus b, where w is the weight or the slope and b is the bias or constant value. Alright, so that's how on the decision tree built on ensembling models, XGBoost is coming from there, which is the point. Now there is another question, is it like we will be extracting features from images before using SVM? In SVM we are not using features, it is just pixels we are using. Next, can you please also highlight on measuring performance metrics? Yes, performance metrics we will go in just some time. That is the next topic. How can we compare SVM and regression, as this is we discussed about the boundary? SVM is also a classifier which classifies the data by using high dimensionality. Can we use high dimensionality in logistic regression? Answer is yes. So logistic regression, somebody asks, can we do this classification of data? Today, due to paucity of time, I could not do it, but tomorrow I'll make sure you will get the logistic regression. Yes, we use high dimensionality for multi-class classification. Application of SVM on multi-class classification will provide good accuracy or lesser than decision trees. See, my knowledge is limited. Based on my experience, I found SVM is better than decision tree in the image classification. I found image classification in SVM. SVM has very good supports like kernels, so there are these margins, etc. So I found this is superior to decision trees. However, as I said, my knowledge is very limited in terms of uses. Application of SVM on multi-class classification will provide good accuracy or lesser. So same question repeated. My experience is good. Can you discuss on Bayesian belief network? It's super complex and takes a lot of efforts to go through that. Maybe some other time we can see this. I want to know on which kind of data this logistic algorithm can be applied. So whenever your data, so the question is on which kind of data this logistic algorithm can be applied. Logistic is coming, mean logistic is where you have classification of your target variable. What you want to predict is who the person is, whether that animal is dog or cat, whether a person will get, say, a person is smoking, whether this person will get cancer or not, lung cancer or not, or so such things, such classification purposes you can use logistic. Now the other one which we commonly use is linear regression. Even you want to know what is the profit that I will get next year, what is the revenue that this company will make next year, how many students will join my college next year. So these are all continuous values. For the continuous values you have to use linear regression. So this is a different between. So the biggest difference here is you use logistic regression when the values are between 0 and 1. The difference is, this is one thumb rule that you can say in a binary format classification. In a linear, the values are between minus infinity to infinity. In real world, you will see more of classification-oriented problem. Yes or no kind of problems, more subclasses, etc. So this is more prevalent. And another question, it says, please suggest an algorithm in deep learning for multi-class classification of medical images. I can say deep learning primarily is starting from neural network. Now and then it will go on. In neural network, it uses logistic regression or sigmoid curve. It uses, we call it a sigmoid curve. So sigmoid curve is nothing but again logistic regression only, right? It is like this. It will have something like this sigmoid curve. I'm sure I'm not oversimplifying it. There is a big concept around it. However, eventually it is the sigmoid curve values are, it quashes the value to 0 and 1. Any value that you get, it is like WIXI, right? When you have 64, we were talking about 70 input variables from 4096. When you have these 70 variables, you will have WX 70 times, so the weight also 70 times plus a bias value. So this sigma WXI WAXI plus B, it has to be equivalent to a Y, and this Y, whatever is the number, that has to be quashed, brought down, scaled to get adjusted between 0 and 1. So that transformation happens in neural network. So this is how one way we can use. Then we can also use convolution method, convoluted neural network, convolutional neural network. So where you can, we use the term feature extraction, but it does not mean you really look at angles. We use the term feature extraction here, where in the previous case we have done PCA to reduce the 4096 into manageable one. In convolution, it will take some high density, high value pixels and segregate and so on. Tomorrow we will look at the entire cycle in a more elaborate fashion tomorrow, and we will understand. This is another way. This is also, again, once everything has to become again a neural network there, and then you will end up using a sigmoid function for classification finally. So therefore, even in deep learning, I will say it is the logistic which is influencing. There we call it a sigmoid function. Then Python, Go, R, which to choose? Right now, R, no. The number of libraries it has and all is very limited. Now after data frames came in Python, Python became more and more popular, R is coming down and down and down. So R, do not spend your time learning it, now not required. programming language Go is excellent. If you are an academician, I think I would say Go is something that you can be more future forward looking. Though libraries are not there today, but you can write the codes. It is the disadvantage with Python are addressed there. Python biggest disadvantage is it is slow. It is really slow. While it is easy and simple to build, so Go has solved the problem. I would recommend Go to use. What are the different application research areas where we can use machine learning and deep learning concepts? See, one biggest area that today the world is looking at is text understanding. Can we make machines speak like humans? Exactly like humans. Sophia is there. Sophia talks like humans. So that ability to understand what other person says and answer, this is one. Second, also because this is my area of interest, that's why I say this as a first. However, there is other one which is ability to take action, so physical actions. So where it can physical or any decision making by itself, decision making, we call it as a reinforcement learning. It will understand from the environment, process it and respond. Reinforcement learning can be used. It may be fictitious if I talk about Robo movie. There is this Rajnikant, for a long time he has been my favorite actor. He has this movie called Robot where that physical body is able to understand. He shows in that movie, if you have watched, there is a book of a medical science where he flips the paper like this and understands what essentially it means is you put the data in a chip and it will immediately be able to process and understand through text processing. That's what is happening. And then the physical organs, etc., with high degrees of freedom of the movement of the wrist, arm, shoulder and body, hip and legs, all of these movements are happening based on the messages that are coming from the mind. So these movements, etc., if we have to do that, the way we say is, all right, now you have an operating system you have and you will have some sort of robotics that you will do. You will create one operating system here and you will have those some degrees of freedom. You will start creating so many motors for every place, for a wrist, for fingers, for arm, shoulder, all of this. You will have motors kept and make sure that the motors do not give the negative feedback. So those electrical engineers faculty will be familiar. You have that reverse effect that can happen sometimes when the power is pushed. Make sure these are handled, and then you have some indexes that are created here for those movements. Now these indexes have to be driven from a software. That is what reinforcement learning has to do for that physical robot to really move like that and make decisions. This is a great, great, great area of research. Now another one is text make like machines. Now if you look at the data that is available, a large, large volumes of data is available around image processing. We call it as computer vision. You have already lot of capabilities, but more and more by looking at some x-ray, can you say that whether is there any malignant cell, which is a tumorous cell that is there in, can you look at an x-ray, chest x-ray, and talk about something else, any degenerated body cells, and especially with the brain, there's so much that we could think of. There is this company you must try and understand what the company does, is called Neuralink, Neuralink, this is by Elon Musk. So Elon Musk, you may know that he is the owner of Tesla company. Tesla is an electric car, electric semi-autonomous car. Now it is pretty much going towards driverless slowly. So he is the owner of the company who started Neuralink, where he talks about the latest researches in this area. All right, more questions that we have, please share. Oh, is my screen not appearing now? Yeah, I'm assuming now the screen appeared. Maybe the question was, I'm assuming the screen is appearing and you are able to listen to me. Feedback and attendance. Okay, so let me go back to a few other questions. Please share the screen what you are explaining during your answer. Okay, sometimes I write here those things. Difference between batches and epochs. This question called what is the difference between a batch and epoch? So this can be useful in a gradient descent model. So we spoke about, the question here is, what is a batch and what is an epoch? Now we are talking about, let's say we are talking about 400, we have images of which we have broken that into 280 for training purpose and the remaining 120 for testing purpose. Is that what we have done? I think 0.3, 30% here and 70% there. Now, when you are trying to use, let's say you have used a logistic regression, you have used for this, and then we spoke about linear regression. Let's say we have used a linear regression and tried to get that M and C value, which is weight and bias value, we tried to get from an initializer, and it gave a wrong number. So, and then you have to, you use a derivative to change this W value, derivative of error divided by W, derivative of W, so that you will get a new, that small delta of W value you are getting, right? So now in this I said you can do a stochastic gradient, which is every one record of this 280, one by one, one person's image or another person's image you can do, or you can do a batch of it. So you can combine 10 pictures together and push them all of them together into this initializers and then go through the model. After that, next 10. After that, next 10. So you will do 28 times to get your all your 280 images processed. The moment all your 280 images processed, while there are 28 batches, you completed one cycle. Now one cycle is called one epoch here in the machine. Now if you run these epochs, we suggest you run at least say 100, 200 epochs. Yesterday I told you iterations. Iterations are nothing but epochs. You run this 2000 times or 1000 times so that this value coefficients of weight and bias, you are likely to get more closer to accurate coefficients that can predict the relation between X and Y value more accurately. This is what epoch is, nothing but that iteration or the cycle. Every time it sees all the values, all the records in a data set is called epoch. A batch is some values, some objects within the data is called a batch. Hoping it is clear now. Then give one example for step-by-step code creation for our better understanding. I will try and do my best there. Can you use linear regression to logistic? Which scenario, sir? Linear is used when your output value is continuous in nature. Logistic you use when your output value Y is binary or classified. Discrete in nature we use. So these two are different things. For multi-view depth videos also we use principal component analysis or not? Answer is yes. If you want to do video analysis, you are going to get so many input variables. You have to convert them, decompose them and generate new set of smaller set of X values. So therefore, recommendation is use it. For multi-class classification, is it possible to draw AUC score? Yes, AUC score. I will try an area under curve. I'll try and talk about it to the extent possible today on the AUC curve. Multi-class classification, you do use it. Perfect. Which is the better for prediction for stock data, either linear or logistic regression? So stock value is output is a linear output. However, I recommend use time series solutions, slightly different time series. What is the scope of computer vision using ML in future? I think ML will have some more time where, so the question is, what is the scope of machine learning in computer vision? Computer vision is about image processing. You have continuous stream of videos coming, you process it and then generate results. So while you have for machine learning, computer vision, for some more time machine learning will answer, I see in future increasingly you will go towards deep learning. See, the difference between machine learning and deep learning is because of hidden layers that you create there. Because you have different ways of convolution, you're not just a PCA. If your PCA is not accurate in machine learning, you will struggle a lot when your variable shrinking happens. But in deep learning, you have these convolution methods, recurrent neural networks, different techniques. So that will help you extensively So the, in future, deep learning has great options compared to machine learning within it. Broadly, both of them will have more options. Which is best algorithm for chronic disease risk prediction? Risk is high, medium, low. It is a discrete value, so you have to have a logistic kind of methods. So generally, I see naive Bayes support vector. Naive Bayes is quite used, and you can also use deep learning models there. There is also a possibility. Now I'm nearing the questions. Which is the best algorithm for prediction of heart disease benchmark data set? Heart is, you start with the SVM, my suggestion, and then go to naive Bayes, then use random forest classifier, then use XGBoost. XGBoost libraries are difficult to download and run. However, these are the four models I would say you use. If your input variables are more than 500, then use PCA to reduce them so that the speed will be improved. Otherwise, if it is a smaller data set, you just go ahead, don't decompose, etc. Directly use this, use one of this and see how the results are appearing. Ordered data or scrambled data. So PCA, whether PCA is used for ordered data or scrambled data. So there has to be some order, to my knowledge, I can check. PCA for normalization of a predictor. Normalization, let me think through how exactly it happens. How the values are collected for the pixel for each column. Perfect. With this, majority of the questions, how the values are collected for each column in the pixels. Now, in an image like this, I'm saying there are these pixels, right? Depending on the brightness of it, if you have, let's say, since we are looking at the black screen, we can't understand what is the value of, since we are looking at white screen, we can't understand the value of black. So strictly speaking, the black is, so instead, let's say that now we keep this everything to a black color. Now, how do I change background to black so that I'll be able to. Now I'll keep this background with solid fill of, if you don't have light, this is what we get to see is this. What we get to see is this. Now in this, if I put a black dot, a big black dot, we can't see it. So that's why this pixel value is zero. Now if I keep, a white dot with the 255 length, I get to see. And now this is 255 value. This is what we are talking about each pixel. When you have very high brightness, it will appear as white in color. When you have no color, which is zero, this is zero value, this is 255 value. And all other in a grayscale version, all others will fall between 0 and 255. Now, depending on the position is computed like this, horizontally it will go first and then let's say you have the 64 by 64, we are talking 64 columns and 64 rows and 64 columns. After first row is completed, the second row becomes the 65th variable in your data set. That's how the data set happens, 65th value in the data set and so on. That's how the image gets converted into these input variables. With this, I hope I've answered majority of the questions. I will now move back to where we stopped our algorithm. Alright, so we have ran and we found that 75 components is where the impact is, where we see some sort of learning here, and I am now using transformation and testing on the data. Now data is ready. I have X-train where my training data set is kept, and X-test is where my test data set is kept. I have broken this into here, if you notice, 400 is broken into 280 in the X value. I have only 280 now. So of course, Y train. This is basically Y train is the column from the target you are taking, 280, and it is a single column, so you don't have anything here. So 280 and 120 we are working with. Now I am using the classifier CLF is what I am creating one now object, and I'm passing there this SVC with the blank, so you can check more details of single support vector classifier in the scikit-learn. We have imported it in the beginning of this algorithm. So, and then you fit this data, basically try and get into a normal distribution, standard normal distribution, fit the data where X train PCA. The PCA new 75 values are going here, and then Y train is our object, whatever the target value for those 280 cases. Then once you fit it, the model is ready. Now predict, Y predict is a new one we are creating, where please predict for me what is the person, who is the person in this 120 records under X underscore test underscore PCA, who are there. Not only that, now you print for me accuracy score, accuracy Y test, Y predict, the inner matrix. The matrix we are yet to see, we will talk about it. We will see the matrix and accuracy score. I pressed and I am getting a 92.92, which is 92% accuracy. In this model, and I just entered and I am getting 92% accuracy, which is excellent. Now, what are these, what are the alternate methods? In this case, I have 40 classifications, there is no problem out of 400 files. So I have 40 different types, it is not a problem. I gave you an example of 1 crore. In 1 crore, you have two classes. Only class 1 is cancer is there, lung cancer. Class 2 is no lung cancer. So these are the two, and in this only 0.1% is here and 99.9% data is here. Then my accuracy score will go for a toss. If I use my accuracy score, 92% means not good. Then what is the other method that we can use, which is what we will see right now. We can skip this. Step 4, we discussed, these are machine learning steps we already discussed, and we could with it. Don't need to worry about. Now, evaluation methods, do we have? Yeah, excellent. I have the data here itself, and I will try and expedite this, otherwise I don't know, we will have to cover a lot of deep learning tomorrow, if not today. Now in confusion matrix, this is a term where for evaluation we use confusion matrix. You have binary classifier, multi-class classifier. We will use binary classifier to learn. In the confusion matrix, I will talk about more things as we go along. There are two types of confusion matrix. One is two-class, another is multi-class. Let us do a two-class confusion matrix. So the concept, I'll go with you figure it, saying that I'll share with an example, probably this will help. Now we have let me change this color to nice bright color. All right. So this is an example I'm saying. So basically a you will get a confusion matrix will have an actual value and predicted value on either side. Let's say you are trying to see whether a person has lung cancer, yes or no. This is what you are doing, yes or no. And you have used the SVM or logistic regression. Logistic regression is easy to explain. So logistic regression, you are saying 1 by 1 plus e to the power of minus x you use, and then now you are, this is actual value, and you are predicting. For one person, you have taken the records of x1, x2, x6, whatever are there, and then you predicted something. So you predict either the person has cancer, yes or no. So I will make this into a 2 by 2 matrix. One matrix I will say that I have, this is my actual data of the person, which is for testing purpose, let's say. And actual, the person has, yes, cancer. The other one, person doesn't have, let's say this is the COVID, coronavirus. The person actually has coronavirus here, doesn't have coronavirus here. There are two types. Now, while irrespective of what is actual, since you use initializers, etc., then the predicted value can be yes or no. Predicted value can be yes, you can predict for some, and you will predict for some, no. Now, it becomes a 2 by 2 quadrant. So you have now, this is the actual, and this is like predict is y hat values comparison. Let's say this quadrant is where truly the actual value is yes, and truly the predicted value is yes. So it is true positive. cancer being yes means positive always. Even in the medical records, if you see, whenever if you look at a blood pressure kind of thing or the blood cells, you will have it. There is a positive, means there is some problem with it. That's what is a positive. So true positive is here. And then here no, and here accurately predicted no, so true negative. Now this is true negative because these two are accurately predicted. Lung cancer positive is there, and lung cancer positive is not there, truly not there. Truly is there and truly not there. Now on the other hand here, while in reality the person doesn't have the lung cancer, but still if the model predicted, let's say, positive, then you call it as a false positive. It is wrongly identified to be positive. This is it. Now the dangerous one is here. Now the person has in reality the person doesn't has the cancer, but the model predicted it as negative. This is a false negative. You wrongly predicted it to be negative while in reality the person has it. So let me see my memory is right, and this is it. You see here, true positive. Probably I will show the screen, entire screen like this, so that we can flexibly write down. So actual and predicted, this should be yes here, and actual yes here. So it is positive, positive, and true positive. So predicted is positive, but actually it is false, so wrong. So predicted is negative, in actually it is positive, so wrong, false negative. This negative, it is actually negative, and predicted is also negative, so true negative. So when actual values and predicted values are correct, then you can say it is true positive or true negative. These are the two values that come under this. In this case, both positive, positive means this is the value here we are talking. Now let's look at like this only. False negative is the actual value is true, the person has the cancer, coronavirus, but your model wrongly predicted it as no. So this is wrongly predicted, so false no. This is the case, false negative. Then false positive is here, the model, they said person has coronavirus and the person is quarantined, is put in the Gandhi hospital in Hyderabad, kept away from everybody. In reality, it has predicted wrongly, the person in reality doesn't have the virus, coronavirus. That's called false positive. Now finally, it is accurately predicted that the person doesn't have the value, which is a very good thing, that true negative. These are perfect scenarios, and accuracy looks at only these two, by the way. Accuracy looks at how many of this is accurate. In any case, now we will see those examples here. Now we will be taking the help of confusion matrix to find various performance matrix. Let us say we have this data of certain people, and the data size is, you can see, 202 people. That totally 202 data points we have. These 202 data points, how many of them are truly positive is 100, true negative is 47, perfect. But wrongly predicted to be negative, while they have a positive, those people are let out to be in the city are 25 people. Though who they have a positive coronavirus, still detected as no coronavirus, wrongly. And wrongly put into quarantine are 30 people. This is the problem now we are facing, and let us see how do we do. Accuracy computation. Normally we will see in the scores accuracy only. What we will do? We will do very smart thing. 100 accurately predicted, 47 accurately predicted. What is the percentage of it? 147 divided by total values. Total is 202. So it is a reasonable, it's a very good number. We say, let's say calculator, I take say for 147 people, it is accurately predicted out of 72% is the accuracy. Good, excellent. 72% is my model accuracy. It is able to predict people have coronavirus or not. Some say I do not have the data, any evidence to talk about. There is one person for whom the machine in US wrongly predicted to her that the person is false negative. The person, they said, you know, negative, the person doesn't have coronavirus and she is let go She went to the city and then she attended a function, family function somewhere, went to a restaurant, had lunch, dinner over next those 3-4 days time, and then she goes back saying, look, my fever is still there, my cough is still there, only for them to realize, look, my equipment is not working, it predicted to be a negative, but in reality you have positive. By that, already damage has been done in those 3 days time. So many people it has resulted in. So this is the challenge. While you say my model is 72% accurate, in the classification, the challenge is these two becomes important. Now let's see the more examples of, obviously accuracy is 72% in this case. This one is okay, but when you have imbalanced data set like our coronavirus or lung cancer, then it is a washout, it is not useful. Then what else do we have? If not this, then we have this precision recall F1 score. We will see a little faster looking at the time. We have only 10 minutes for today, and probably tomorrow again we will do extremely fast. Now precision is computed. Precision means exactly how many times you exactly computed whether a person has coronavirus or not. So the person here computed, obviously here if you see, the exactly it computed 100 cases. Out of how many cases we had coronavirus positive? 130 people, no, this is 125. 125 people have coronavirus, but the machine has accurately predicted for 100 cases. So the precision comes to 100 by 125, which is 80%. Precision is 80% for the model. Let's see, it is, we got precision. Well, this is a mistake. Precision is computed. It is not about exact of what is there actually. My predicted values, how exact are this? This is the small error. So the predicted value, so therefore it has to be the value. How many times I predicted the person is positive? That is a 130 number of times I predicted the person is positive having coronavirus, but only 100 times this is accurate. 100 times only this is correct. So in this case, 100 by 130, this was the doubt I had, which is now good. Now we have 76.9, which is 77% of the times it is exact in terms of predicting that the person has coronavirus. This is another metric. This is also not a best metric for us right now, but for us the best metric, we will go into it. However, we need to be aware of recall is what I answered in the previous case. Recall value, how many times it was able to recall accurately of your total positive things. That recall it has provided me as 100 by 125, which is 80%. This is recall. Now let's look at the precision and recall. Both combined can give us some good answers. Precision being exact, how many times you correctly predicted out of 130 you said as positive. Recall is how many times you correctly predicted against the actual number of 125 people who had coronavirus, 80%. Now finally, specificity. There is one more element we will look at. Specificity talks about how many, so the way we can say a specificity is true negative rate. You said that the person doesn't have a cancer, how many times you have accurately said that the person doesn't have coronavirus. So proportion of actual negatives that are correctly identified, that is where you can say specificity here. Now, specificity, so these many times it has it's wrongly said the negative value. So the way we can compute here is 47 by 30, we can make it 47 by 47 plus 30. So 47 is the number of times it truly negative it has identified, but there were other times where it is sort of similar to recall from the negative point, where truly negative as well as the machine could not identify other people who were also negative, and these were sent to for quarantine. These 30 people were sent for quarantine. So this 30 is a big error. The specificity is a problem for us. So we can compute it with it. I'm sure this will be 47 by 77, which is 61%.
Alright, now let us look at the F1 score, which is a reasonable metric for us in an imbalanced data set to look at. What F1 score does is precision and recall, it multiplies. So two times of precision and recall, and you sort of average that value and the total data set. So now to just repeat, for F1 score, what we are doing is both the precision, which means how many times I exactly predicted somebody having coronavirus out of total number of times. Total, I think, was 130 people. My model said they will have coronavirus. In reality, only 100 people had. This is precision. Recall is how many people who actually had coronavirus and you predicted correctly. You predicted for 100 people. There are 25 more people you predicted them wrongly. You have considered them, the other 25 as they don't have coronavirus, and you let them go to the city. Now I am using these two things, and I am using this multiply it with 2. So 2 times I am bringing these values, and then I am using the same value to reduce it once. So precision plus recall if I do, and I will get the F1 score. And this score can help in the imbalanced data set. This is what we should compute it. Now, given the time, ROC curve and RUC, I will not, AUC, area under curve, I will not highlight it. It will consume time for us. Now, however, at a high level, so you can look at true positive rates. You can do sensitivity and recall computation you can do to get this data. Broadly, for logistic regression or any classification, use F1 score and some bit of sensitivity data to compute it. I will go back, look at the model and say, did we use what we have used here is, there is this library called matrix within the scalar. Otherwise, you can always use the formula also and you can get them, F1 score, etc. In the matrix, you can ask for the comprehensive report. What I did here is, give me the classification report of every value for the person 0. There is one image, right, of person 0 to 39, all the 40 people, give me separately. So I can ask that using this method called classification report. So where I get precision, recall, and importantly, F1 score. Number of values is, that is okay. How many values we have are 3 people who are being computed. The total number of people are 120 people who are computed. Now I also have put together one, not in this, I will run another file where I try to keep only for one person. I'm hoping you are able to see. We have a few more minutes to go, and let me quickly run this. Face recognition 2. No, this is a difficult model. I'll show you a simpler one that I have. Maybe this one. Okay, so here, tomorrow we will talk about these epochs, etc. Tomorrow we will cover it. But today what I want to show you, I need to run this something. I've got cumulative sum. Tomorrow I will share a single line. I'm also noticing that here I found matrix.accuracy_score. Accuracy score I got here. Precision recall here. If I want F1 score, which is collective, one average F1 score, which is 92%, my model is extremely good that way. I'm able to say 92% with 92% accuracy who the person that we have analyzed, which is good. So very quickly I will go over. I have imported a few libraries in the beginning which are relevant to call the data and compute the data, then matplot library for visualizing the information, then machine learning using scalar. Then loaded the data from the Olivetti faces. I will share this model with you. Then checked what we have, printed for reference. Otherwise, without this also you can go. This is also without this you can go. I will go to a simpler file which we used for our explanation today. So now in this, if you see, very, very clean file. You have 1, 2, 3, then 4. Oh, that's all. These are all kept under markdown, which means without that also your model coming. Then you have put it in a shape, train, test, split, decomposed it, checked your decomposition so that where you can look at the data. Finally, use 75 and you have transformed it. Then ran the model here. ran the model and then predicted the values, and to see you have accuracy score of 92. In this, interestingly, because it is small one, your F1 score is also very good, which is at 0.92, which is good. So cross-validation is a different aspect that we, is a method in which somebody was referring to improve the accuracy, we can use that. However, 92% is accurate for us to go. All right, I'm very glad, and hopefully you understood something. Tomorrow, we'll try and provide the neural networks. We will run the same Olivetti phases into the using neural networks, a lot of equations, little bit of heavy for half an hour, 40 minutes. However, I'll try and simplify that, and then we will listen to convolutional neural network. I also have Anuradha ma'am here. Perhaps she, I'll request her to share some views about what are the next steps and so on. And announcements, some interesting and exciting announcement too.
Day was also exciting to you as far as the learning goes, and the form was shared and most of you have already filled the feedback today, and I saw a very good feedback already. Wanted to tell you that tomorrow is the last day, so we will be dismantling the groups based on your feedback. So in the feedback form tomorrow, we'll be including whether you still want to be notified about further sessions, or you want to be associated with us through Center of Excellence, or to be associated in whatever way. We'll ask a question to you tomorrow in the feedback. If you want to be associated, we'll be forming groups. All those who don't want to be associated will no longer be troubling you, and we'll be dismantling the groups. And moreover, even the YouTube videos will be available only till this weekend. If you want to brush up, please brush up all your knowledge through these videos before the weekend. And any additional suggestions or additional requests you have, please notify in the groups or write to us, or send me a note, then we will look into it. And don't worry about the attendance, especially the projects. We have circulated already. Did we circulate projects? Okay, we'll be circulating today the template for submission of your project ideas. And there are certain parameters. Please make sure those parameters are met while you are submitting your ideas. So further the steps I'll convey to you tomorrow morning. Have a great day, rest of the day, and we'll meet you tomorrow. All the files and documents, videos, all this we'll be sharing today by end of the evening. Thank you so much.
So we can conclude? Perfect. See you again tomorrow. I'll end the stream.